Great. I guess I'll get going. So as I mentioned, I'm going to be speaking about aquaculture and aquaponics. I'm going to briefly go into what is aquaculture, why do we do aquaculture, why is it necessary, where does it take place. I'm going to talk about aquaculture species in Ontario and the farming systems that we use to grow fish in the province. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about aquaponics as well, what aquaponics is, system designs and species selection between crops and fish. So if we start briefly with aquaculture, aquaculture is more than just fish farming. We typically think of aquaculture as fish farming or fin fish farming, but it encompasses the farming of crustaceans, mollusks, and aquatic plants and algae. In fact, mollusk aquaculture is the oldest form of aquaculture in North America. It was practiced by indigenous peoples in the Northwest, along the Pacific Northwest coast, over 2,000 years ago. And what these indigenous peoples did is they created what are called rock gardens or terraced gardens that basically improved the both the size and the number of mollusks that could be grown on the ocean. So really, mollusk farming is the original form of farming in North America. If we look at why aquaculture is important, and everyone will have their own reasons for why they feel that aquaculture is important to them. But if we look at globally, we know that it's mainly a matter of supply and demand. And quite simply, our global demand for aquaculture, which is really a product of our growing population, and then our growing amount of fish and seafood that we consume. We actually eat more than two times the amount of seafood per person on the planet that we did in the 1960s. So we're consuming far more seafood products per person, plus our population is growing rapidly. This all combines to create a real demand for seafood globally. And we know that wild caught seafood can sustain some of this demand, but really the amount of wild fish and seafood we can harvest from the ocean has plateaued or diminished since the 1990s. So what we really need globally is for aquaculture to fill in the gap between what wild caught can produce and what the human population demands. If we look at Canadian aquaculture, we really don't grow a tremendous diversity of species. Aquaculture production is really concentrated in Atlantic salmon for fin fish, and then oysters and mussels for shellfish. There are smaller species like rainbow trout that accounts for about 6% of the production. And of this 6% of total Canadian production, over 50% comes from Ontario. So Ontario is Canada's largest or number one producer of rainbow trout. If we look specifically at Ontario production, as I'd mentioned, rainbow trout is really the dominant species in Ontario aquaculture production. But we have minor species such as coho salmon, whitefish, Arctic char, and shrimp that make up a smaller percentage, and they're grown primarily on land-based systems. They make up a smaller percentage of Ontario production. If we look at how we farm fish in the province, and I had mentioned that aquaculture is more than just farming of fish, but the majority of aquaculture within Ontario, mainly because it's a landlocked freshwater province, it has to do with rainbow trout farming. And we grow rainbow trout and other species in a diversity of systems. So the most common system is open water net pens. This is the top left picture there. You can see large, very large rectangular pens are suspended, or they're anchored to the lake bottom. This picture here is in Lake Huron. So net pen farming takes place in large water bodies such as the Great Lakes, and it accounts for about 85% of all of our production in the province. So very valuable and important way to grow fish for us here in Ontario. Another valuable and important method of growing fish is land-based flow-through systems. That's the top right picture that you can see there. And here we grow a lot of our brood stock. Here we grow a lot of the fingerling that gets supplied to the net pen systems, because net pen aquaculture is only what we call a grow out system. So it's an area that we bring fish that are already, say, at a juvenile stage. They're 20 to 40 grams. They're about 4 to 6 inches. So they're not what we call baby fish. They're sort of in the adolescent stage, and then they're raised up to the adult stage in net pens. Whereas land-based flow through, they act more as a hatchery. Of course, you can bring fish to market size with land-based flow through systems. Another form of aquaculture is recirculating aquaculture systems. I would say this is a bit more of a newer system, particularly when it comes to growing fish for market-sized fish. Now, recirculating aquaculture systems take place indoors in insulated buildings, and they recycle and recirculate the water continuously throughout the system, which allows for a diversity of species because you're able to heat the water now with recirculating systems, so you can grow warm water species. And it also reduces things like water demand, or it improves biosecurity. So there's some real advantages to growing and recirculating aquaculture systems. We've also seen some non-typical sites being developed. This is the bottom right picture. This is an abandoned or decommissioned quarry that has been essentially filled by rain and groundwater to produce what really is a small little lake. And then on these lakes, they are mini, they're not net pen systems because they're closed containment. So they're not a net, but they're a plastic membrane that's holding the fish in place. And they're kind of a hybrid between a flow through raceway and a net pen system. So there are some non-typical sites. We've seen in the province an old mushroom farm being converted into a tilapia farm, hog barns altered to put in recirculated aquaculture systems. So there are some non-typical sites that people maybe don't think of naturally, but that can be quite suitable for aquaculture. I would just point out that Indigenous peoples and Indigenous communities are highly involved in aquaculture in the province. They are a major and active part of aquaculture. If you look at net pen farming, there are many examples where either an Indigenous entrepreneur is working, say, independent of a community on a net pen farm or, through ownership of a net pen farm, or whether there's a community involved in net pen aquaculture that's working in participation with a non-Indigenous established aquaculture company. So there are many examples of that throughout the Great Lakes. There's a new example up in Lake Superior. So net pen aquaculture is just, we're testing the waters of net pen aquaculture in Lake Superior. Biktagong First Nations involved in that project. There's a great new project out in the west end of Manitoulin Island with Shashaguani First Nations. There's a land-based facility being developed near Peterborough with Curve Lake First Nations to grow warm water species. So just a few examples of where Indigenous peoples are actively involved in aquaculture in the province. Now, if we turn our attention to aquaponics, I'd mentioned briefly about RAS or recirculating aquaculture systems. So essentially what aquaponics is it's a hybrid system between RAS aquaculture and hydroponic cultivation. So Fatty had mentioned a lot about vertical farming using hydroponics. And I had briefly touched on RAS aquaculture. Well, when you merge the two together, you get one complementary system. And essentially what happens in the system is that the fish provide nutrients for the plants, and the plants filter the water that returns back to the fish. So we really look at this as a symbiotic relationship or a mutually beneficial relationship. And it involves, as I'd mentioned, fish and plants. But the aquaponics system is really fueled by the microorganisms. So it's really a three-way symbiotic or complementary system. Now, when I talk about microorganisms, I'm just talking about the small little tiny bacteria that we really can't even see that exist within an aquaponic system. So essentially what happens in the aquaponic system is the fish farmer or the farmer feeds the fish, and through metabolic digestion, the fish excretes ammonia through its gills primarily, but also through feces and urine. And what happens is that the microorganisms are able to convert this organic waste into available nutrients for the plants. So when a fish defecates in the tank, those nutrients aren't automatically available for a plant to uptake. It takes an intermediate step of the microorganisms making this organic fish waste bioavailable to the plants. And then the plants are able to take up what's called nitrate, which is the nitrogen source, which is beneficial for the fish because when your nitrates elevate to too high a level, it becomes detrimental to your fish. So it's a mutually beneficial relationship involving fish, microorganisms, and plants. That's a really good simplistic way to look at aquaponics. And then within aquaponics, this is a picture here of a farm just outside of Toronto. Now they're in a greenhouse setting, but aquaponics can be done in indoor containers in a vertical farming setting. So it's quite flexible as to where you put aquaponics. And they essentially have, there's essentially two forms of aquaponic systems. One is a coupled system, which is essentially a single loop system, and the other is a decoupled system, which is a multi-loop system. Now, within every aquaponic system, you can use different plant or crop growing systems. So you could have the picture here that we see, that's deep water culture. There's also a technique called nutrient film technique, and there's a technique called media bed technique. So you can have different plant growing systems within an aquaponic system, and I'll talk about all this in a sec. So if we look briefly at a coupled aquaponic system or a single loop system, and we look at the flow of water that's shown here in the diagram, it all starts at your rearing tank. So that's where you hold your fish or your crustaceans. And then water, this would be your highest point in the system. Water would flow by gravity into a solids filtration machine or compartment. Here you would remove the solid waste because we really don't need all the solid waste that fish generate. A large portion of their the nutrients that they excrete are dissolved within the water column, and that's enough to power our aquaponic system. So we want to remove the solids. They can cause bad things with anaerobic digestion where they start to break down without the presence of oxygen, and this can be detrimental to your system. So we remove the solids, the water goes on to biofiltration, and this is where these microorganisms, as I mentioned, they do their thing here. And what they do is they convert ammonia into nitrites and then into nitrates. So this conversion process makes it less toxic for the fish and more available for the plants. The water then flows into the plants. The plants use all the nutrients available in the water, including the nitrates, which can be detrimental to the fish. So they use up some of these nitrates. The water flows back to your sump. Now, if your water is, if the nutrient levels are all sort of where they should be in your sump tank, you won't have to add any sort of additives. If your nutrients are off a little, this is where you would add your nutrients to your system in the sump tank. And then you would have a pump in your sump tank that pumps it back up to your rearing tank. And the water just continuously flows in this sort of direction or flow continuously. So it's a closed loop system that continuously cycles this water through this process. If we look at a decoupled system, they are a little bit more, say, complicated or complex. But if you really break this system down, it's two loops of water that cycle independently. So the loop on the left is the fish loop, which is signified in a darker blue, and the loop on the right is signified with a lighter blue. So what happens is that essentially the water from the fish loop continuously circulates in its pattern. However, the solids from the solid filtration are removed from that loop and added to the plant loop through a biodigester and then into the plant stump. So the advantages of a decoupled system are that you can have two different water temperatures. So if your fish prefer a cooler water temperature, the temperature within your water, your fish loop, can be cooler than your plant loop. So you're able to optimize the conditions for both the plants and the fish, which is really the drawback of the single loop system, where you're at the mercy of one consistent water temperature, one consistent pH, and these sort of water variables. So there are really a lot of advantages to operating a decoupled system or a multi-loop system. Now, if we look at the ways in which we grow the actual plants themselves, as I had mentioned, there are sort of three predominant techniques. One is on the far left. This is the nutrient film technique. And essentially, the plants are just held in small little, very fairly shallow troughs. And a small skim of water, just a film, is pumped, and it runs along the bottom of this trough. So essentially, most of the roots sit in open air, but some of the roots suspend into this film of water. They have another quite popular or common technique, which is deep water culture or raft culture. That was the first picture I showed you there. That's the middle picture here. And you can see polystyrene rafts support the plant roots, and they suspend right into the water itself. So the roots are almost entirely suspended in water. You will have to aerate the water in this instance because the roots are continuously in contact with water, which holds less oxygen than air does. And then the third technique is what's called a media bed technique, and it uses small little inert substances. It could be sand, could be gravel, could be clay balls. And essentially what this is it provides root support for the plant. So the plant roots grow into this inert media, but it's also a place where the microbes can colonize and sort of do their thing to convert fish waste into available plant nutrients. So all the techniques sort of have their own advantages, disadvantages. It's more sort of a matter of personal preference as to which you utilize. Now, what to grow in aquaponics is quite a common question. And really from a plant's perspective, the options are quite wide and diverse. I mean, typically, typical species for aquaponics are generally leafy greens and herbs. Those are sort of the two most predominant types of plants, but you can grow things like strawberries or melons or tomatoes or, you know, edible flowers. There's a real wide range of plant species that can be grown in aquaponics. It's really not that limiting. I would say the fish species is a little more limiting because most plants require quite warm water. So you really have to grow fish species that are well adapted to warm water. And so you can see within this fish species list here, they're pretty much all warm water species. You've got a cold water species, which is rainbow trout, but its temperature tolerance goes up to 20 degrees. So if you're at the upper end of the rainbow trout temperature tolerance and you're, say, growing a leafy green that has a lower temperature tolerance in the low 20s, you could be quite successful. Or maybe you're growing a decoupled system where you can have, as I mentioned, a different water temperature for your fish than you do for your plants. But it is something to bear in mind that particularly if you're in a coupled system, that you really have to pair your fish species with your plant species. And really the most important variable would be temperature, but you also have to think about availability of nutrients as well. Now, if you're looking for additional educational resources, there are a number available. So Through the Ontario Aquaculture Research Center, we offer OBAFRA and the research center. We kind of combined to put on a workshop. So this is an in-person workshop. It's a one-day event. It is resuming in April 2023. So if you're interested, you can contact aars@uofguelph.ca. And then if you're looking for online resources, the Ontario Aquaculture Research Center has developed a free online course in aquaculture. So, you know, that's a very good resource. You can kind of do it at your own leisure, and it provides some good information if you're thinking about getting into aquaculture. If you're looking for more formal education, Fleming College offers both an in-person and online aquaculture course. So they have a co-op program where you attend college for 8 months, and then you do a shorter practicum at the end of your 8 month, two semesters. Or there's a course called Aquaculture Foundations, which is an online course that you, once again, you can do it at your own pace. And it covers much of the same material as the co-op program. So those are some educational resources that are available to you. A lot of them are free. Some of them are paid, but they're out there. They're available for you. As I had mentioned, you know, I couldn't make it today up to North Bay, but that doesn't mean I'm not available for a discussion at any point. If you're thinking about getting into aquaculture and you're looking for additional information and resources, I'm only a phone call away. You know, I'm only an email away. So feel free to reach out to me at any point in the future. But once again, sorry I couldn't make it. Hope you enjoyed the presentation, and I will try to answer some of your questions if there's questions at this time.
Thank you so much, Michael. Just speaking about that, we are running a little bit long. He does have his email address on screen if anybody does want to make use of that. Additionally, if someone needs that email address, it can be provided as needed. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you,
everybody. Yes, so with those, what we're going to do is the PowerPoint presentation and the video counterpoints are going to be put on the website. It's going to be up to Lynn to coordinate that, but yes, absolutely, they will be provided. We do have those digital copies here. Okay. Yeah. You're referring to seafood harvesting rather than, yeah. Yes, okay. I wouldn't have that answer, but we can get that. Oh, yes, here we go. Could you turn my mic up on pot one? So Michael, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Yeah, so the question that was asked in person was, is there going to be opening of organic harvesting of wild shrimp at any point? And I know that that might be a government question and you may not have that answer, but I was going to open the panel with that.
Is this a question for organic for harvesting of wild shrimp in Ontario?
It's not, it would be, so for instance, wild hunting of, say, any game in Ontario. What he's asking is wild harvesting of shrimp. So it doesn't relate to agriculture or aquaculture. Oh, enclosed. Okay, sorry, I'm getting clarification on that. So shrimp farming itself, so it would be related to your industry.
So just so I understand the question, are we going to be able to produce or grow shrimp in the province in the future? Is that the question?
Yeah. So, you know, if there's any conversation or if they found a solution to what happened with the shrimp, because they had to shut everything down, right? And we're all kind of getting involved into looking at the possibilities of raising and creating that shrimp farm.
So to answer that, just shut down, right? To paraphrase, he can't hear you. But yeah, I'll come on up if you want to. But yes, the question is, will there be shrimp farming in the future in Ontario?
So just for everybody's when you're asking a question, you have a lead up to your question, but very directly the question is for the folks online that are doing the presentation so they can respond. So online they can see the presentation, they can wait. but they can't see us. So,
right. That's right.
They can't hear us, and we unfortunately don't have to fight.
Yeah. If you want to go up and ask.
Yeah, I was just about to see if there's any, there has been any dialogue on finding that the real thing is the cigarette industry because they found it.
Yes. Okay. Right. So, yes, to answer, to communicate what the person said. Yes, it would be shrimp farming in Ontario. Michael, do you have maybe any insight to that?
I mean, I guess I can provide a little information. So currently there are shrimp in the province of Ontario that are being cultured. They are in on what I would call sort of a special permission granted through CFIA, because there has been, back in 2019, there was the detection of IHHNV, which really put, which really closed down the shrimp industry in Ontario. But there is a company that's trying to develop in-house brood stock. So there is shrimp production going on in the province, not on a commercial scale, but more on a development of brood stock scale. If the company is able to develop and secure brood stock locally, I would say it's very promising that shrimp can be grown in the province. If that's not a possibility, it would still rely on Ontario importing what we call PLs or juvenile shrimp from Southern American states or Mexico. If that's still the case, it would be a difficult business proposition to be in, because if you do import a shrimp positive for IHHNV, you could go through the same sort of problems and shrimp industry closure that we currently have. So, I mean, I really think it depends on the development of local brood stock within the province. Otherwise, it's going to be a difficult business proposition to be in.
Okay, so in short, I guess, yes, but not yet.
Yeah.
We'd be that there. So, yeah, excellent.
Thanks.
Yes, thank you, Michael, for that. No, he's saying and confirming thank you. That's the information that he wanted.